2 Samuel 6 chapter, one verse in your hearing.
All right.
If you have it, say, I've got it.
I've got it.
If you don't have it, say, hold on. 2 Samuel chapter 6, verse number 14. Amen. There you will find these words recorded. And David danced before the Lord with all his might.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And David was girded with a linen ephod. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. For a few moments of our time, we're going to share one another. I want to preach from the Spirit of the Lord, as the Spirit of the Lord shall guide, from the topic uninhibited praise. Uninhibited praise. Amen. Let's look to the Lord together. Father, it's in the name of Jesus that we come. God, we're humbled by another opportunity to share your word. Thank you, God, that your word is a lamp to our feet and a light to our pathway. Thank you, God, for this series that I believe will shift our church to another level of worship. Thank you for these who have gathered to hear a word from you. God, is preaching time. And I can't preach unless you preach through me. I can't move unless you move me. Can't even walk unless you hold my hand. God, hide me behind thy rugged cross that men will see you and not me. Take me out of self and use me for your divine glory. Decrease McCray now that you may increase in the name of Jesus. Lord, if I'm too high, bring me down. If I'm too low, pick me up. If I'm too far, draw me in. Give me your divine power to preach to your people. Now, Lord, let the words of my mouth, meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. All who love the Lord shall amen. Uninhibited praise. Hallelujah. There is an article that I ran across the other day concerning an experience some U.S. missionaries had on an evangelistic crusade. These missionaries, beloved, were in Zimbabwe attending a worship service in the Debel tribal village. Most of the Zimbabwe worshipers were wearing their finest clothes, certainly as it relates to their context, as they sat on the dirt. They didn't seem the least concerned about where they were worshiping or its present condition. They weren't bothered that there was no roof or no adequate floor or no podium. They weren't worried about whether or not they had nice padded blue cushioned pews that y'all sitting on. They weren't worried about organs or a fly band. They didn't were concerned about a drummer or a bass player. On the contrary, they shared with the U.S. missionaries how grateful and appreciative they were that there was a man who had allowed them to hold services under the leaves of his tree. These United States missionaries chronicled how the Zimbabwe natives were so humble. Their shy smiles and fleeting eye contact was indicative of the fact that they were perhaps intimidated by these U.S. missionaries' presence. The tribal pastor prayed and officially welcomed the small group of the U.S. missionaries. The pastor delivered a powerful, uplifting, and inspiring sermon. And as the worship began, these Zimbabwe worshipers immediately and eagerly were on their feet. In spite of the fact that shoes were a scarce commodity, which made foot ailments and deformity the norm, the U.S. missionaries stated that transformation had taken place right before their eyes. The Zimbabwe natives had such joy and smiled with their entire faces and sang and danced before the Lord. The article shared how passionate they were, and it described the depth of emotion and energy that the Zimbabwe worshipers invested into their praise and celebration unto God. After a while, these white, traditional, church-going U.S. missionaries were dancing and singing and laughing along with the Zimbabwe brothers and sisters. Even though the U.S. missionaries didn't understand their words or their worship style, and even though the atmosphere was foreign and unfamiliar to them, the Spirit of God united them all in worship and praise. They noticed that their sincerity and sentiments they exhibited was far from the gimme health and gimme wealth and gimme happiness worship that seemed to be so prevalent in our culture, our church culture. It was far from the when the praises go up and the blessing come down mentality that fuels most of our worship experiences. In spite of their great need and obvious lack and of resources or modest living, these Zimbabwe worshipers clearly expressed their love for Jesus and their deep gratitude for the grace he had provided them. They worshiped God with complete abandon. The experience was a living picture and testimony to the authenticity of true worship. The author of the article reflected on the experience and stated this: I may have more stuff and fewer life and death burdens, but they have an abundance that I lack. The Zimbabwe worshipers had a pure, unadulterated faith and blessed hope and an authentic love for one another, the Lord, and life itself.
Yeah. All right.
It seemed that no load was too heavy to weigh their joy down. No obstacle was too big to hinder or stop their praise. This was my favorite statement, beloved, as this U.S. missionary finished the powerful observation. She said that the Zimbabwe worshipers' focus was entirely upward focus, not on the circumstances surrounding them. And as I read this article, I began to reflect on the countless opportunities of worship that I've experienced and had the privilege to be a part of. I began to really think and reflect about the many times that I've witnessed in many church services and how praise teams have to sing and solicit congregation to worship God, or worship leaders who have to almost beg us and pump us and push us and coach church attendees to participate in the praise. And in that reflective moment, I begin to ask myself a series of questions. I begin to ask myself, what is hindering us from worshiping God with that same type of abandon and passion and energy as those Zimbabwe worshipers in the article? Have we become so obsessed and overly consumed with our creature comfort that we become incapable of tapping into authentic worship? Have our cars and our clothes and our cash been a curse and a distracting force as it relates to our passion in worship? Has our Western culture caused us to lose the freedom and liberty that true worship affords? Have we allowed life's trials and tribulation and troubles to suppress and snuff out our ability to give God an uninhibited praise? Well, brothers and sisters, I don't know about you, but my desire is to give God an uninhibited and unrestricted and unrestrained and unsuppressed and unrepressed, the unreserved and unselfconscious praise. And I don't know about y'all, and it's truly a sad commentary and a real sorry belief psalmist of Israel named David. Now, let me give you the background so you can appreciate the breakdown. At the time of our text, King Saul, Israel's first king, is now dead. The first five chapters of 2 Samuel chronicles David's validation and confirmation as the new king of Judah and Israel. Through much war and killing and bloodshed, David had become their sole leader. The kingdom was united now, and King David was anointed and was the unrivaled king of God's people. David, who was already Israel's champion as it relates to war and combat, David set out to overtake Jerusalem from the Jebusites. David captured and conquered Jerusalem and named it the City of David. David was now walking in his purpose and in the manifestation of God's divine selection. God's selection and appointment of David as king in the backfield of Jesse's sheep barn had finally come to fruition. Under his new reign as Israel's king, he became more and more powerful. God's approval was obvious and apparent. God showed his favor toward David by allowing some messengers to build David a palace in Jerusalem, which was now the new capital. God's blessings were upon the kingdom, yet David realized something was missing. Chapter 6 chronicles David, King David's plan to return the Ark of the Covenant, or what the text described, the Ark of God. You see, the Ark of the Covenant, beloved, was symbolic of God's promise and God's presence. Maybe y'all didn't get that. Let me back that thing up and moonwalk and say it again. The Ark of the Covenant was symbolic of God's promise and God's presence. David was at the place of fulfillment. He was walking in his purpose. He's blessed. The kingdom is unified and blessed. He has overtaken and conquered the Jebusites and the Philistines in battle as the official new king of Israel. And he realized that the presence of the Lord was missing. Yeah. Let me park here parenthetically and put this in your spirit. I don't know what you do or where you find yourself. Don't you do anything without his presence. Now, and the Lord blessed Obed-Edom and his entire household. Word and he was jumping.
Thank you.
Now here's, here's where it gets interesting. This is the moment in the text where it gets real sketchy. Check out what David's wife, Michal, does and says to him after she saw him dancing and praising God. I'm gonna read you verse number 16 and verse number 20. She saw David dancing before the Lord. Bible said, and as the ark of the Lord came into the city of David, Michal, Saul's daughter, looked through a window and saw King David leaping and dancing before the Lord and hearing David, and she despised him in her heart. You're too worried about what right now. And you forgot that the praise is what got you that job in the first place. Some of y'all got more Brian House now. You forgot. When you ain't had that, you couldn't even pay your bill. You couldn't even pay your rent. You was up in here crying and snotting and running all up and down here, but now you got your little house and now you're too up in it.
Before
praise ain't for you. My praise ain't got nothing to do with you. I'm here to give God the glory. I'm all I'm trying to rush here. Number one, David informed his trifling, stuck-up wife, my praise ain't for you. The second reason David gives that uninhibited praise is this. Hear me. David told Michael, this man, this shouted me last night. I couldn't even go to sleep. I kept on reading over and over and over. All week this shouted me. I couldn't even do no work at night. So don't you recall that? I couldn't even work because this word shouted me. David told Michael, yeah, he chose me. Yeah. you get a praise under God. You ain't got nothing to do with who's on your left or on your right. Because they ain't got no heaven or hell to put you in. Most of us who call friends, they ain't in your friend. But the moment you start shouting, they're going to go laughing at you. Behind your back, look at her shouting at you. And she just was doing so and so. Y'all know how we talk. She got the nerve to be, he got the nerve to be running, and I saw him smiling up in so and so face. Trying to authenticate somebody else's prayer. Why you some type of kingdom watcher? When you ought to be a kingdom worshiper. Stop worrying about what everybody else is doing. Stop trying to be little Jesus. Ain't no more Jesuses. There ain't no more. That's all they want. Stop trying to be baby Jesus. Because if there was a cross and some nails.
Say that.
And a crown of thorns for you. You break that door to get out of here. Say no more, Lord Jesus. I'm here. Say no more, Jesus. Stop trying to be baby Jesus. And praise God that He chose you. Friends that don't know the Lord. I got friends that ain't thinking about God. I got friends that are not saved. I got friends that don't even believe in God. Do you know that could have been you? But He chose you. Before the foundation of the world, before your mama and daddy hooked up, God chose you and predestined you to be a child of God. I'm finished. We all are creations of God, but not everybody is a child of God. By divine election, God has chosen you. As crazy as you are. As mean as you can be. As much as you lie. And are shady and sketchy. He chose you.
All right.
Mixy, my daughter would call it. As mixy as you are. He chose you. That's enough to give God praise for every time you come to the house of the Lord. I'm finished. Everybody stand. Who are we? I'm standing. I'm out of here. Everybody stand. Who are we to sit on God with our arms folded?
All right.
Never opening our mouth. Never acknowledging His goodness. Who are we as if we owe God something?
All right.
I heard a song say, I owe Him all.
That's right.
My hallelujah belongs to Him.